Academy. There's probably 60 or so students here and some faculty, and then there's probably an equal number of people from Maples. So it's a perfect environment for us to talk about some of the big subject issues. So without further delay, I will introduce first to welcome you to FGCU, my boss, the Dean of Arts and Sciences, Bob Gregerson. Bob arrived here in 2 years ago, 2014. And he's just been a wonderful dean for me. I love him to death, and I'm not just saying that. Anyhow, I'm getting some points here. So here's Bob to welcome you.
Thank you, Bill. I'll echo what Bill said. It's great to see everybody here. This is such a wonderful speaker series. I hope you can come to all five of them, and we've even got some guy named Bill Mitch giving a talk later on, I think in the third, in the bi-weekly series of talks. We're delighted to have you here. I want to invite you, if your schedules permit, to come up to the main campus sometime, up in Estero, and see what we've got going on up there as well. Lots of also interesting talks that are designed to bring the community onto our campus. Art, music, theater, performances, exhibitions that I think many of you would thoroughly enjoy. So glad that you're here, and I hope we can see you on the FGCU campus sometime soon, often. If you ever need to figure out what's going on, just go to the FGCU website, and you'll probably be easily able to navigate and find speakers, art shows, things like that. So. Welcome again, and am I going to introduce Bernie? Okay, so back to Bill to introduce Dr. Bernie Sanders, who we appreciate so much for his support. Did I say Sanders? Bernie Masters, I'm sorry. Sanders. He didn't even count. You caught it.
I did. That's a good
show. I like it. And the Hefter family for their generous support of the reception tonight. So. Thank you, Bernie Master.
Okay, thank you, Bob. All right, I'm very pleased, before we introduce our speaker, to introduce the person that made this happen, really, because it's to bring in speakers like this, you have to have some resources, you have to find the best of the best, and in order to do that, we had to have some support. And Bernie Master and his wife, Susan, have come through courageously for several years to support the entire series. And so I think it's very proper that I give the floor to Bernie. He has been a longtime friend. We were friends together. He was on my advisory committee when we were all Buckeyes at Ohio State University. And we've known each other ever since, so we're delighted to have Bernie's support. Bernie Messer.
Thank you, Bill.
Wow, great for our first lecture. Tremendous, tremendous. Am I okay, Lee? Yeah, okay. I'm going to add my welcome. I've been associated with Bill Mitch back in Ohio State University for over 20 years. And I was on his committee to help him create the wetlands, the famous wetlands at Ohio State University. It's been a model throughout the world for man-made wetlands. And when Bill came down here, he knew that I was living first in Naples and then in Marco. He invited me on his committee with many like-thinking people like you all who want clean water and clean air and clean soil. We don't listen to the talking heads on television to get our information. We're not watching Fox News for our environmental information. We're not reading the paper to find out what's happening with our environment and Mother Earth. We're bringing in the top scientists of the world, such as Dr. Lammers, to get base scientific information from the people, the men and women who are creating it. This is firsthand stuff you're going to hear tonight and throughout our lecture series. What he's going to tell us and all our other scientists, he has and they have created. It's reproducible. It's arguably unassailable, although it's great to argue about these concepts. These are teaching concepts that when we listen, take mental notes, and we take it home to our families and our friends and our relatives. So thank you for coming tonight and helping us spread the word about what we really, really believe in. Thank you very much. I wanted to, before we introduce our speaker, I wanted to call attention to one more person that's supporting this session, the first session. Where's Bill Hefner? Oh, he's way in the back. Phil, stand up on this. Bill Hefner, another guy from Ohio, yes. Bill has co-sponsored this session and especially helped with the social event we have up there. So thank you very much, Bill. Speaker of the day, Professor Leon Lamaris is a biogeochemist and ecologist, and he heads the Department of Aquatic Ecology and Environmental Biology for the Institute of Water Research at Radboud University in Nijmegen, the Netherlands. He is also a scientific advisor of the department's spin-off company. Isn't that a cool idea? They have spin-off companies. and it's a funny name. It's got an acronym, but it's called Beware. Can you imagine? Dean is probably concerned about that. Beware Research Center. Whatever, that's what he said. And they experience a research consultancy for water management, nature management policy, and a number of national committees advising on nature and water management. He teaches fundamental and applied ecology, biogeochemistry, microbial ecology, water management, nature management, which, by the way, I told him that's ecological engineering, and he agreed, right? And water management. The research department includes fundamental and applied ecological, biogeochemical, microbial research. This is the stuff we really need to have. And it's in freshwater wetlands, lakes, rivers, and coastal wetlands from different scales, all the way from an organism on a small scale to landscape and even global level. Leon has been always enthusiastic about applied ecological and biogeochemical science with a strong societal impact. This approach has unveiled novel fundamental insights more than once, and I think we're going to hear some of those today, because there's all new knowledge about key factors and key processes in a wide range of ecosystems, new types of approaches, and serendipity. So, without further delay, I'm going to introduce Leon Lamars, Professor Leon Lamars, and he was going to talk about the Dutch solution to floods. Live with water, don't fight it. Leon, welcome to the stage.
Thank you very much, Bill. I'm delighted to be here and honored, and I'd really like to thank you once again to invite me over to Florida, which is one of my favorite states, I have to say, this country, and especially the swamps are my favorite, actually. And I'd also like to thank the other three Bs. Actually, I learned that they're all with the B, Bill, and Bob and Rena and Bernie, yeah, and I'll use a different last name then. Well, I'm really sorry that you didn't make it to the election. I think you would have made a great president. So yes, thank you very much again. And so what I'm going to talk about is not only about the differences between our country and your country, which is obvious, but also about the similarities, and especially regarding water issues, because we have a lot of water issues that are quite similar, very, very similar to what I've seen here. My first time here was like 10 years ago. I was invited by the South Florida Water Management District because they had issues that were similar that to what I've been had been publishing about. So that was the first time I met a lot of people here and alligators, which is great. And I was actually flabbergasted about how much it looked like what I'm used to in our country. It's totally regulated. The water management is totally regulated for the most parts of the Florida. The only differences are, like I said, there are more alligators than we have in our country. It's a bit warmer. I actually left my country on Sunday and it was freezing. So I'm really happy to be here. And everything's bigger here, of course. Water works are bigger, the pumping stations are bigger, the canals are bigger, but it's totally similar and the issues are similar too. And I would like to talk about that. But most of all, and that was why I like really particularly like Bernie's speech, that I like to invite you to become even more enthusiastic about wetlands, because I love wetlands, and I know, and I'm really happy that you all came here. That means to me that you love them too, actually, or you just want to see a weird Dutch guy. but I think maybe both, yeah. So I'm also looking forward to the discussion afterwards, and what I want to show you is that we've been doing water management for a very long time, and that we actually moved forward to a place that is something that Bill is also involved in, and has been involved in much longer than I was, is ecological engineering, which is like a hybrid between engineering and nature management, including restoration, ecological restoration. And I think that is really important. Just before we started, I talked to Bernie, and I would say that I think it's very easy to disagree with people and to, you know, stand there and start fighting and later on yelling. That's very easy. It's much better actually to look at what you agree on. And I think instead of engineers and people in nature conservancy or biologists, ecologists opposing each other, it's way better to first think about what you actually agree on. Jump on that train, and then you sit at a table and start fighting each other, but you're on the train. I think that's important, because for a long time that didn't happen. And there's a lot to actually disagree upon, but you first have to start with what you agree on, I think, because that's much more fun. So actually what I'm going to do is not show you, I don't think I put any graph or equation or other boring nerd stuff in it. Apologies to the students. Feel free to have another lecture afterwards that has no limit. So this is actually what I'm going to talk about. First thing, which is the most important thing, is about the zoroastrian. Then I'll talk about the fact that they are actually fine, and there's a lot happening in wetlands all over the world. And I'll show you, not only show you a lot of different wetlands, just to just get an idea of the diversity of this planet, which actually strikes me every day. Then move on to the idea that especially people at the low-lying places or on the coast, but also in the river floodplains, have always regarded water as an enemy. But a strange kind of enemy, because it also provides fish and can go boating on it, and it's important. Most people actually on this planet live along the river or on the coast, because that's where you can trade, where you can have food, and jump into the ocean to cool down here. So, and what I want to do is to show some of the new insights leading to solutions, how to turn this enemy forward to a friend. And that involves ecological engineering. And someone came up with the name Building with Nature, which I like very much too, because it shows that you're actually walking arm in arm with modern nature, which is a very nice metaphor, I think. And then I'll show why wetlands actually are also commercially and from a societal point of view the most important nature types that we have. I don't say that the other types are not interesting. I've actually in December I was in Death Valley, and I loved the desert, because that's also all is about water there. If you don't have enough water, there's a big problem, and there's not so much water there. That was actually the only time I could go for a hike, because in the summer it was hot. And I end up with showing that, unlike many people think, that wetland management is really expensive, it's cheap. And, of course, the final message will be that they're our best friends. So why wetland biologists? Well, that's where all is happening. You know, it's a place where you can find the unexpected. It's a place where things happen. I actually went to a screening Jay Hawkins for, I think, three times because he passed away, before he passed away, and he's a great singer. He's great too, he's a big singer too, but I love him. It's like voodoo blues right from the swamps, and you recognize the other pictures too, I think, depending on your age. So what makes a wetland a wetland? It doesn't have to be wet. We actually went to Corkscrew swamp today, and large parts of that were completely dry now. But the whole community that is there, including the animals, actually only thrive because of the action of water. So also a floodplain that can be like dry for 6 years is still regarded as a wetland, because the flooding determines what is there. The animals and plants that don't like to be flooded or drowned, they will not be there, and the seeds that cannot be transported by water, they will not be there too. And actually, it needs a reset every time. And the students know much better than me, maybe even, to have disturbance and have high biodiversity. That's the key thing in these floodplains. So you have permanently or periodically anaerobic or anoxic conditions, which is a pain in the ass for all the organisms. You might think that plants don't care actually what's happening low ground, but that's where the major part's happening. That's where they have to get their water, that's where they have to have oxygen actually. So plants can die because they drown, because their roots need oxygen. So if you live there, then you have to be a very smart plant. So you only have smart plants and smart animals in wetlands actually. They have to be able to withstand anaerobic conditions or just be above that. And that leads to an incredible heterogeneity that actually don't have their equal in any other ecosystems, I think. Well, coral reefs, but I see them as wetlands too, because I like them a lot. So high biodiversity, large sweep of societal services, and I think wetlands are more exciting than drylands. But I'm a wetland scientist. So. Just give you an impression of how diverse a wetland can be and how diverse the wetlands on our planet are. Different places that I've been visiting, and many of them I've been doing research together with my students, postdocs, and assistant and associate professors. We were just this morning discussing these structures that are actually snorkels for the plants when the water table gets too high, and they actually also emit CO2 and methane, so there's a lot of exchange actually, and a lot of larynchymus, so pores. A lot of nothing is actually in it, so the gases can easily pass. This morning I was delighted to see a toddler gator there too, and it was really great to visit this place. And Bill told me he calls it his cathedral, wetland cathedral, and I totally agree with him. It's really beautiful to go there. A couple of years ago, I was also in the Everglades National Park in the Sawgrass parts, which are totally new, were totally new for me. This is place Sablo, actually where Odin and the brothers, the Odin brothers, actually spent a lot of time, especially I always forget who was spending most time on Sablo Island for his research.
Gene.
So we're doing research on these systems of coastal marshes and see not only whether they can keep up with the sea level rise, but also how to actually help them to be restored or to have higher resilience, because there's a lot of die-off lately in the last years because of drought. So you get a combination of drought events as a result of climate change and higher sea level as a result of all the things that we're doing on this planet. This is in Holland. It's a peatland, actually, with cotton grass. And also wet place. This is also in Holland. It's one of the Ramsar sites that we have in our tiny country. And actually, this is a man-made system, which is interesting. Because when I was a student, I learned that, you know, you have the highest biodiversity when man doesn't interfere. That's not true, especially in our country where we have a lot of manure, so it's actually one big shit country. Because there are so many nutrients, there's so much nutrients, nutrient levels are so high that you get the same thing everywhere. And that's not what we want. We actually signed agreements at a national scale, international European scale, and at a world scale to take care of them. And what you see here is because of the high nutrient levels, you get the same thing everywhere, and actually because of activities of man, which is peat extraction here, so for turf, to burn it, back in the medieval times, but also until the beginning of the 20th century, and it's still going on in some places, not in our country, but in Germany, for instance, and that created a lot of heterogeneity. So when I teach an international class of students, and people are coming from Costa Rica, they look at me like I have like, how many heads did they say in America? Like three heads, four heads, five heads, something. Because they say this is like gardening. But I explain to them, if we don't do that, we have so much nitrogen, for instance, coming from the air, which is 100 times as much as there should be naturally. My American colleagues at that time called me a moron, and I had to go back into the lab because that was 100 times too high. And that's true, but the measurements are true. And when the water quality is really poor, so you have to do something to keep the biodiversity. So that was interesting. And you see an interaction between culture and nature, which is actually a ecosystem engineering upon a lip. This is another place. This is an art. And these are students. And really happy, as you can see, doing research in these areas on terrestrialization, so the change of water into land again, and something in between that you cannot call land or water. And farmers actually say it's fish can't swim in it, and you can't walk on it. And so it's something in between. But these are very species-rich systems, actually. You find a lot of different species that have adapted to these this situation, either at the anoxic spots or at different pH, and you have small gradients. So when you actually sit on your knees, you see micro gradients. When you look around, you see a gradient from one place to the other. When you actually have a drone or you can fly yourself, you can see it at a bigger scale. And the bigger scale is really important, because that one of the big things, big issues actually with wetlands is that they are connected to other places. If you're a nature manager, you can actually stand on your head, which is a phrase in Dutch, which means that you can do anything that you would like to, but it's not going to change the water quality. You have to talk to the water managers. You have to talk to the community, because there's a lot of users for this water. So it doesn't make sense to just put a fence around it, because the water quality is not going to change, be changed by this fence. One of my favorite places, the Connemara. We go there every 2 years with 20 master students. And this is also a wetland. It's a very high place, but because it rains a lot, it is, like my friend often says, suspiciously green, which means that it always rains. And they have blanket bogs like this, which is also very, very beautiful on a great scale. And it's always great to be in Ireland.
Some of the places you would like this too.
I also like to go to Oregon. Because I like the Cascade Mountains a lot, and because my girlfriend lives there. So we still have to figure out how to make that work. But these are very nutrient-poor sites. They are volcanic lakes, they're very low in nitrogen, very low in phosphorus, and they're totally different systems again. And it's great to paddleboard. I learned to paddleboard in 5 days, I think. Another wetland is the Wadden Sea, which is actually the sea, a small sea behind the Barrier Islands. If you go to Georgia, you have Barrier Islands there too. So that was one of them. We had that too, because our country used to be one big estuary or river delta. And it was great because we had to work low tide at particular spots. We used this very old-fashioned boat that doesn't have a keel, so it can actually run dry, and then you need a ladder to get on top of the boat. A lot of fun too, actually. One of the systems that are regarded most pristine in our country. This is looks familiar to you, I think, but this is actually in Kalimantan, in Indonesia. And what you see is coastal protection in a natural way, like you have here too, at some spots, many spots. A lot of things are happening, mostly residencies. And you see another thing too, that seagrass that is growing here. So we normally have barriers, like first you have coral reefs, or oyster reefs, or mussel reefs, and seagrass behind it. So that these reefs facilitate the seagrass. Seagrass also attenuates the waves, and then you have either coastal marshes or these beautiful mangrove systems that protect the land that's behind it. If we remove that, you can say that you can make a lot of money by, you know, doing other stuff with that. But if you look at the longer scale, especially when the climate is changing, it is not that smart an idea, because you will have way more flooding, like you saw in Louisiana. And well, we are still in this country and in Europe, we're rich enough to prevent that. But if you live in Bangladesh, you have a problem, actually. And if you live in Louisiana and you don't have much money, you have a problem too, I think. So, This is also where we did research on the interaction between green turtles and seagrass. If you see someone with a striped shirt on or like doing thing underwater, it must be me. We're actually making exposures to see the effects of turtle grazing on it. Another one in Finland, beautiful bogs. This left Finland is one of the countries that still has a lot of wetlands, actually. And if you look at a smaller scale, you see these hummocks and hollows of different species. These are peat moss species that actually produce the peat that's being extracted from turtles. But it's really beautiful, and you can, you know, for you don't have to be in Lord of the Rings, but you can just walk here and you know, even drown if you're not in the another one that made it is very familiar to Bill too, I think it's Emma, Estonia. Oh, there's an L in here, sorry about that. Estonia. And these are very beautiful too. This is the places where you can still walk. This is where you might not be able to walk, and this is where you have to swim. And a lot of research is being done because these produce a lot of methane too, and what the interaction is with the climate. But these peatlands are the biggest store of carbon on Earth. So they are really important. If they dry out, so if you have desiccation and water shortage, a lot of that will be released into the atmosphere, adding up to the CO2 levels in our atmosphere. And I always like it when school kids are involved. I saw that here too. These are the happiest frogs I've ever seen, actually. This is in Wales. One of my PhD students, Eva, we're doing research on the interaction between nitrogen deposition and the plants that live there. Actually, a lot of plants have adapted to low levels of nutrients. So when you fertilize them, a lot changes. And this is a bog in Alberta, in Canada. I collaborated with people from Philadelphia that do a lot of work there. It's actually the places that are in the news every year because of the burning. The burning that is going much faster lately than it used to be. It used to be like once every 120 years now. So went down to one every 19 years because of more episodes of drought. I'll take you down all the way down to Argentina. Our queen is coming from Argentina, so I should include something of Argentina, Tierra del Fuego, which means the land of fire, because the people always have fire because it rains even more than in Ireland, and they have to keep themselves warm, actually. And this is also a very beautiful spot, but they're changing that too. They're also extracting ether. So that's a big issue there too. So you would regard this a forest, which is true. But if you look closer, actually when you stick your head into the ground, which I do a lot, and then you can see that there's a lot of carbon. Actually, they are huge carbon stores. This is again in Kalimantan, Indonesia, starting new programs next year, because there's a close connection between our country and Indonesia in the past. And you see it as a storage of organic carbon. So when you extract this, and when you lower the water table, a lot of the carbon is going into the atmosphere, and it makes it more prone to fires. And you've seen that for Kalimantan, it's going at a very fast rate. And then along with that, you lose beautiful species that are very rare, like orangutans, which makes it even worse. These are pigments too. And they store a lot of peat. Everywhere around the world there's a lot of peat, and it can be burned. This is an early Van Gogh, or I should say Van Gogh, although I'm not from that part of the country that hears this ridiculous sound. I don't like it. So as I pronounce it, the French, the Van Gogh, Van Gogh. These people are extracting peat, very poor people, and they use it as a fuel. And that's one of the uses for paint, which is still done in Ireland, where you can see it. So the blues. The fact is that we lost half of our wetlands already, which is really troublesome because fresh water, clean fresh water, is such an important thing. It's actually one of the most important things on this planet. You know, you can survive much longer without food than without clean water. So the glass is held empty. And that's really concerns me. So that's another reason why I became a wetland scientist and to actually tackle these challenges or try to tackle them. And if you, for instance, go to a huge wetland in the Mesopotamia area, which is Iran, Iraq, and I know that you have a different association with these places, but actually that's one of the places where civilization on our planet started, along with the Indus River and later on in the Nile River. That was complete, was a wetland, because wetlands produce fertile soils. That's where you want to be, that's where you can grow your crops. And that has completely been drained, actually mostly because of Turkey using up all the water upstream, which again shows that you cannot solve the problem by just looking here. And then a guy called Saddam Hussein actually did the rest. I think that would have been a good reason to invade the country instead of now, because he really kicked out, I think, about 40,000 people who lived there and had been living there for a long time. It was bad person. So the cultivated systems use up 25% of the Earth's terrestrial system. And that means that we have a lot of land use change, because we need pastures, we need croplands to produce enough food for all the people that live on land. So you can use wetlands in different ways. This is actually a kind of mountain again, that's mining. It's coal mining that is very shallow, and actually they have to remove the top layer. This is also in Indonesia, actually supported by the Dutch government, because we were so good in draining everything. This is a plantation for oil plantation. This is in Indonesia again. This is a shrimp farm. So, of course, you can make money out of it. If you look at the longer term, this is an economically non-feasible and non-sustainable way, because only one or two persons that already have a lot of money make more money, and actually a lot of people lose the services, including the coastal defense systems, because you don't have any defense system anymore. These are the mangroves. There are no mangroves anymore. You can imagine if there's a tsunami or just a storm surge or a hurricane, that hurricane doesn't matter, that doesn't mind that this is just going directly to the place where people live. So we might think that we've been doing bad things for like 100 years or maybe 200 years. It's totally not true. I'll take you back, and when we actually all, as you all know, we were all Africans. We started here and first went to Asia, some of them went to Europe and kicked out the Neanderthal people. Still have their luck actually, because they like each other very much. When you look at the animals that are big and tasty, and especially the ones that are slow, they actually were used up. So in Africa, you get co-evolution together with the animals that were living there and we as an animal. And so it didn't go down that much. But once, for instance, Australia was invaded by humans some 10,000 years ago, and there was a rapid extinction of mega means big vertebrates, so that's the animals like we that are tasty and you can hunt for. And when, well, not you guys, but the Native Americans that are here, or the first generation people from Canada, came from Asia, then suddenly all the big animals were eaten up here too, and the same as later on Madagascar and New Zealand when we were there much more recently. So we have a huge impact, a huge footprint already for a long time, ever since we left Africa. And that leads not only the change in land use, but also climate change and the change of water quality, for instance, and air quality. Actually, so these are the major extinctions when you go back 600 million years ago, and you see that everything's going well actually, because there's still more species. And you can see that there were these events here where you have major extinctions. The one that's most famous, of course, is the one at the end of the Cretaceous, when all these beautiful, fluffy dinosaurs actually died out. But there have been major events like this, the Permian Jurassic event, like 250 million years ago, that had such an impact. So this was because of an asteroid hitting Earth, that's almost certain. This mainly was because of volcanic activity. But actually, if you and I would be sitting here in 100 million years, which is quite long because we haven't been here not even for a million years, so when we would be sitting here, we would see that we have the sixth mass extinction that is similar, and there have been a couple of recent, even more estimates using models, that is similar to this one here. Now we are to blame. So you can say that it's bad or it's good, at least you have to think about it, because we are responsible for that. So we could, or we also have to take our responsibility, at least, to rethink whether we are doing it in the right way. And so that's something to, that we, a lot of people don't, even biologists don't think about, because it's at a long scale, but the rate of extinction, of loss of species, is like 100 times higher than the natural rates and the normal rates. Okay, so this guy is coming all the way from Holland, which is only a small part of the Netherlands, and as I said, I don't like the sound that's from Holland. I'm not from Holland, I'm from the Netherlands. These are my shoes. And I didn't bring them for now, but Holland is here, or the Netherlands is here, this is France, this is your big friend here. And this is where Estonia and the other Baltic region, the Baltic states are, that are a little bit afraid of your big friend here. And so it's a very tiny country. Actually, I looked it up. Before that, I would like to show you just this little cartoon that is about our country, and it's an American cartoon. It's a very happy one. It's a motion picture and showing how people from the U.S. think about people in the Netherlands. The sound is starting in a minute, I think, and. I like this song very much. I have three different versions of it. I like the lyrics. It says they had so much moon that it was a real Dutch treat, which is two jokes at the same time, but it's not in this part. Which refers to the Moonlight in Marsh.
Far from the sea in Holland, in the land of wood and shoe, there's a story nearly everyone knows, and I'll tell you how it goes. There lives a Dutch hill, there lives a Dutch hill.
It's a Dutch people. So what you can already see actually is how our flat land has very low parts there too. We're making buttercup. He's bringing milk. Stop here now. I like this very much because it is about our country. I like the lyrics very much. And refers to windmills, and I'd like to say a little bit more. Well, first, that was what I just mentioned. This is our country. So our country fits 4.5 times in Florida. So what am I doing here? So 4.6 actually. I'm here because we have similar problems. The water actually is coming to our country. This is where I live. This is Germany still, to the River Rhine, one of the major rivers, the river is coming in. So we live actually in an estuary that should be totally wet. And we transformed that into a desert, something that you did to most parts of this state too. And actually, as most of you know, a large part of our country, the dark blue part, is below sea level. So when you land, maybe you have ever been to Schiphol, it's called Schiphol, or Schiphol, or whatever you want, which is actually 4 meters below sea level. A lot of the places have been, the water has been pumped out, and actually this wasn't land, this was made by the Dutch people. This was an inland sea, And we changed that, with the big dam here, and this became, instead of a saline inland sea, it became a freshwater lake, actually. And this is still below sea level, but we put dikes around it. Dike is a Dutch word. And pump the water out, and now it's new land. So it's often said that God created the earth, except for Holland, that was made by the Dutch, actually. If we wouldn't have protection, so I would like to make that clear. I'm not someone who's going to tell that all this coastal protection is nonsense. You know, I am living near Holland here. I would have, you know, 20 minutes to go to the coast, which is good, actually, for me. It's worse for these people, and it's actually where most of the people in our country live, near Amsterdam, Rotterdam, and in between here. So you can see that we actually live in the sea. We transform that into land. So if there is a country next to other low-lying places on Earth where it's important to think about coastal protection, that's our country. It's not as bad here, but if we think about sea level rise, and this is the place that has an elevation above the main sea level within 5 meters, I think we have to swallow it. And because, of course, now it's not happening, but for sure, in the future, and maybe not your grandchildren, but your grandchildren's grandchildren, have to take care of that. If you think that facts don't matter, today is a special day, it's the end of truth. For me, I can say that I'm European, I can just say anything I want, you know. But it is, for a scientist especially, it's really, really an interesting time when facts don't matter anymore. You can come up with graphs, loads of graphs and figures, and people say, well, my belly says something different, that's just an opinion. Which is, let's say, it's interesting. According to 99.5% or even more, I just heard of the scientists, this is going to happen. And actually, every time we get something in the news, it's happening much faster. So, maybe not for now, but you know what happened in a lot of places in the US also, but also in other places, that flooding happens more often. And now, 5 meters is not that scary, but I have to admit, the first time that I arrived here, that was in Palm Beach, and later in Orlando, but also when I was in Miami, I looked at the houses. It's really great to live there and you see, but no one in our country would ever live there. It's a scary place. It's beautiful, but it's scary, I think. Maybe not now, but in the future it is. And actually, at the barrier islands, like in Georgia, they were already preparing for that because they were building two-story houses with the first story not being used, or maybe the park probably don't have the cars. So be prepared. Whatever, let's say, the president might tell you, it's going to happen in the future. So you'll need protection. And actually, you're going to have to hire Dutch people. I'm not an engineer, so you're not going to hire me, so I'm not here to get more money. Because they have an experience that goes back 2,000 years. Actually, my hometown, which has 160,000 people, is the oldest town of our country. It's 2,000 years old, exactly. And it was started by the Romans. And actually, when you look at the Roman place, this is a reconstruction of our town, Roman. You can see that there were dikes already, and they were actually preventing their residences from being flooded. And this is what later on, in medieval times, people were building dikes, and you know, when the water raises, then you put one more stone on top of that. And you can see that here, this is in the 19th century, and I think it's the 19th century. The other big castle in the past, and you see dikes here to protect it. These areas were being flooded. These were used as agricultural lands for grazing. And later on, we started building houses there, which is makes sense, but also doesn't make sense, because those are former floodplains. So to get rid of the water, we use windmills. So that's why I used the, not only because it was a happy cartoon, we used windmills. These were the first pumping stations, actually. which means you have like a series of four of them, and they cover up to, I always have to translate that into something that doesn't make sense, 25 feet, in Virgil. So that was happening already. So we were pumping it out, and in this way we were able to live at places where you shouldn't be living from a natural point of view, actually. And you can see that here, this is Skinner's egg, and maybe some of you have seen it, it's very famous because there's a lot of windmills at one place. But you can actually see this is agricultural land here on this side. And this is actually where the water is being pumped out here. This is lower, and you can see that by the windmills in the past. Now it's by electrical pumping and engines. But it was pumped right into this part and then going into the channel. So this is much lower. This was already like sometimes like 10 feet lower than the actual water layer. So you needed additional protection. And the other issue that came then was that the water that was coming from agricultural areas had to be discharged into other areas. Often those were natural wetlands, which means that you actually have a very dry system here that has to be protected, which is low, and a higher place where you discharge water that's being loaded with nutrients. So there comes the similarity with your state here. You actually, during summer, for agricultural purposes or for natural places, for nature reserves, you don't have enough water because the water is being used up for other reasons. And when you have a lot of water, even too much water, it's polluted. So that's exactly the same thing that we have in our country, which is a problem for the wetlands here, particularly the Everglades. You either don't have enough water or you have too much water and it's totally polluted with nutrients from agriculture. And we're all responsible for that because we eat the sugar or other crops that we eat. So that was followed, the windmills were followed up by steam engines, and it's still there. You can visit it. Beautiful. And you can already see that the land behind it became lower and lower. That's because it's peatland. So it's like 8 meters, 25 feet of peat, or even more, and it's subsiding. It's going down like 3 feet every 100 years, so it's going down. And when you visit our country, you can see that the water is often much higher than the land where all these crazy cows are grazing. So this is just a little bit more exaggerated. So we see land subsidence here, which is really severe, and that happens in other floodplain areas and coastal areas that have peat along the world, around the world. At the same time, the sea level is rising. So when you land at Schiphol, just remember that it's actually a very scary place. Not as scary as Lauderdale where I landed. That was really sad. Especially to me as a European, that's really sad. Because we have different laws. Again, I can't say anything, I'm European. It's okay. Remember that wetlands are wetlands and they are connected. So once you do something somewhere, you not only influence the quantities of water, but also totally influence the quality of the water. And this is our country, and it's red because it doesn't meet the European standards. We actually, like I just said, we have a shit country, and it's also referring to the water that we have. It does not meet the water quality standards. And the water quality standards are even higher than the standards that are proposed for the wetlands here. So that is scary, actually. And I'm really happy that we are kind of part of Europe. Well, the country that you once kicked out, kicked itself out of the European Union, you know. But, so we have a big problem. And we found out that we were thinking it's much better than in the 70s, but it's still, you know, really bad compared to other countries. Same thing happens here. This was the Everglades in the past, and Bill showed some other cartoons to me too. And what has changed is not only the total flow of water, but also the direction of the water. And when there's too much, it's also directed into the Gulf and the ocean, and leads to problems there because it is heavily polluted with nutrients. So you have similar things. So even though our country might look totally different, we have the same issues, actually. And especially when you don't have enough water, and the only water that you can use is actually polluted. So you need, for instance, stormwater treatment areas. You need a lot of them. And they work, actually. I was astonished, because they're much bigger than the ones that we have. So you have to actually adapt that. And the pollution, eutrophication means pollution with nutrients, has a lot of effects downstream. So nutrients is not a bad thing. There's no plant that doesn't like nutrients. That would be a stupid plant. So this is the natural type of eutrophication, of nutrient pollution. I have cormorants here, called guanification, guanotrophication. Guano means actually just this catalog word, which means shit. And then that was big business once, because we didn't have enough nutrients. The strange thing is, we can make as much nitrogen as we want chemically, but we cannot make as much phosphorus as we can. Actually applying way too much phosphorus on our land, and it's accumulating. So once it was there was a deficiency in phosphorus, then we used a lot of phosphorus and actually spoiled a lot of nature reserves. And now phosphorus is getting depleted. Most phosphorus has to come from Morocco and from northern Africa, and it will be not enough for the future. So it's going to be expensive. So again, we have a similarity where, even though there are big differences too, where you transfer nutrients from a place where you actually need them to a place where you don't want them. What's the problem with that? Well, the problem with that is that some plants are better adapted to higher levels of nutrients, and they're suddenly very happy. So this is the main thing that happens with high nutrient levels, is you get plant growth, and you get the fastest growth of grass-like species, graminoids, including grasses. And this was done in a fertilization experiment. This is a control. You don't add anything here. You added phosphorus, nitrogen, and both, and you can see that this responded to phosphorus. And you not only have fast growth, but also lose a lot of species that don't get light anymore. Actually, the nutrient pollution leads to light problems. You can see fast growing species like these in our country. And in the water, it changes. Plants are foraging too, they're just doing it very slowly. When there are not enough nutrients, like in Oregon, like I showed, that plants have covered the whole water layer because they're foraging for water and also for light. When you add nutrients, like you change it a bit to the Florida situation or the Dutch situation, then you get dominance of algae or blue grain algae, and plants have to grow very fast, or you get duckweed or other floating species that can be eaten up. Finally, you end up with cyanobacteria or blue grain algae, which is also toxic to cattle and toxic to your dog too, and to yourself when you drink it. Leading to pollution, this is actually the south part of Lake Okeechobee, where I was, and we often regard a lot of species like the water hyacinth as invasive, noxious weeds, but actually we facilitate them. They cannot be invasive if the water quality would be okay, because they can only grow like hell when you feed them like hell, and food is coming from the, mostly from the sugar cane fields. Transforming the situation of sawgrass into something that is dominated by cattail, leading to a lot of changes also for the animals that live there. That's happening all over the world. This is the Murray River in Australia. You can see this is not a normal color of water, actually. And these are all agricultural fields, and it's runoff nutrients there. And that is brought to the coasts, where it's leading to problems too. Not only for nature, but also for recreation. Told me that there's like a fence there, the people who actually depend on recreation, like the skippers, they really are not happy with what is happening. Transforming on nutrients. We did research in Indonesia, and you can use seagrasses to monitor how many nutrients are coming into the sea, and you can find it like up to 10 or 20 miles or even further out in the ocean. So we tried to clean the river, and that worked somehow, a little bit. So we're meeting these standards, which are still way too high. But still we had problems, and that was when I was asked to come over to talk about sulfur too. And this is not only about sulfur, sulfate is also running off from agricultural fields here in rural areas, very high sulfur concentrations, and I've done some research on the effects of that.